In this video, I want to try and explain a bit about the compliance testing we've been doing. So, first question is, what is compliance testing? If you've ever looked on the back of a product before, you'll often get these little symbols. In fact, this one looks like this is the Taiwanese compliance testing. But if it was sold in the EU or America, it would need the CE certification for Europe or FCC for America. And what those certifications mean is you're allowed to sell the products there. So it's important if you're making a product. Why they have them is mostly these days is for not making a mess of other people's radio. So because there's so much communication that happens on radio, like Wi-Fi, mobile phones, Bluetooth, all this kind of stuff. If you make a Bluetooth device and it is much louder electromagnetically than it should be, maybe when you turn it on, it interrupts your Wi-Fi or it stops the ambulance radio communication from working or something that we really don't want as a whole group of people using radio equipment. So with certification, one of the most important tests is you put your product into a special chamber, which is an anechoic chamber. So it stops all the radiation from leaking out. It's like a sealed room. They use them for sound as well, but this is a special one for radio waves. And you put your device under test, in our case, a keyboard on a special rotating turntable. And then everyone leaves the room and you use antennas that are fitted onto these structures that can go up and down. So then you spin it around and you listen to it to find out where the worst emissions are. And there's certain guidelines that you have to follow. So they scan a whole frequency and you've got to make sure that the level of your emissions is below a certain point. So that's fine. We managed to get through that. And then there was being immune to when, say you're at home and you're using your keyboard and somebody turns on a hairdryer, then all of a sudden you get a spike in the voltage. That spike goes through your PC and you'll get a little bit out through the USB as well. And so the keyboard has got to keep working there. So that is immunity, conducted immunity, because it's the signals are being conducted through the wires and the keyboard has to stay immune. So that was fine as well. The one that we failed on was the ESD testing, and ESD stands for electrostatic discharge. And what that is, if you're ever in an airport, this always happens to me in an airport, I'm walking around in the airport, I grab something and I get a little shock. The way they test that is, on this picture here, you have a special gun, and there's two tests. There's one where you're putting the spike in contact with the keyboard, and you put 4,000 volts very quickly, like the kind of spark that you get if you're walking around an airport. And on the corners and in the hub, all the kind of places where you think it might be weak, and the keyboard has to keep working. It's allowed to reset or to put the lights to flicker, but if it stops working and it doesn't start working again, then you fail. And what we had was, there was a couple of weak points on the Hubble where if you zapped it just right, it would reset and it wouldn't reconnect with the computer without plugging it out again, so it failed. So the first thing that I started doing when we got back to the UK was talking to a consultant I know to give me advice on how to fix that, and then trying as best as I could to check it here without this equipment, because these are like 4,000 or 5,000 euros. You can hire them for about 500 euros for a week, but we wanted to just try some stuff quickly. So I made up this ghetto ESD testing platform with a little spark gun here. There's a layer of silver foil underneath, and you can see an incredibly quick spark, but it's basically just a cigarette lighter where I entered the gas out. And the idea is this is plugged into a computer, and then you spark it in its weak points to get it to reset, and then you can try different things. So mostly what I was doing was adding extra filtering on the ports, adding some extra capacitors to soak up that brief charge to stop it from resetting too badly. And then we sent it to the UK to get it pre-tested again, so we could get that done really quickly. And we passed, so that's good. Just a quick demo of this then. So as well as doing the, when you were zapping it on the board like this, you in connection, you can also do it where you're a little bit further away, and that creates like a electromagnetic shock wave that passes. And one thing I noticed as I was doing the test, if you watch these green lights up here, these are kind of my online services that I'm monitoring. If I do a few clicks on the So this would fail the ESD air shocking because it is. No, it wouldn't fail actually. This would be a car speeding pass because it's affected when it boots up. But it would be a fail if it failed and then it didn't reboot. This is a test report from our friends at Unit 3 Compliance. They're really good guys if you need any testing done. And they tested it slightly higher than we needed to make sure that we pass when we do the final test. Now what I've been doing is back on the hull, I've gone through all the places where I added these capacitors, so more on the power supply, more on the filtering for the USB, more on the reset circuits, added extra ESD protection, all this kind of stuff. And now I'm in the last little bit of work in doing the final bit of routing before the new version of the Hubble is ready to be made again. So that's the compliance in a nutshell. And then we'll go, after we've built a whole new set of PCBs, we'll have them built up in China. Our factory will take them to the testing facility that we're using there and do the FCC and the CEC, the CE, and a couple of other ones. And then once you've got CE and FCC, those are the strictest ones, so it's easy to then get the other tests, usually just by filling in a bit of paperwork. Fingers crossed everything will go well. We'll get those two main certificates and then we'll be able to start applying for the other ones as well.
Thanks guys
for watching my video.
If you're interested to learn more about the Raise keyboard, you can click the subscribe button. Or if you're interested to purchase one of these beauties, you can head over to our website at dygma.com.